Thank you very much. So thank you, friends, for joining in today's online teaching session. We had a very scintillating talk a couple of weeks ago by Manglani ma'am. And I think, you know, I'm getting now requests again for a few people. Can we have it again weekly? So that means there's a lot of interest still in these online teaching sessions. And, we can figure that out from the feedbacks we get and also from the attendance, which has been pretty consistent. So today, again, you know, we're coming up with a very, very important and an extremely common and relevant topic, and that is autoimmune hemolytic anemias. It's one of the common diagnoses in hematological settings. At the same time, poses a lot of challenges, not only in the diagnosis and workup, but also throws a lot of challenges in the management, especially the ones which are the difficult ones. And they couldn't have a better team than the PGH Chandigarh to take this, a difficult subject and a common subject to dwell on. So I should thank Dr. Richa Jain and the PGI team for volunteering and, moderating today's session and taking today's session on. And I also want to thank her colleagues from PGH Chandigarh who have, devoted their time this evening with us and going to share with us their thoughts on this topic. So I'll introduce, Dr. Richa Jain doesn't need introduction to this audience. She's assistant professor at Postgraduate Institute of Medical Science, Medical Education and Research at Chandigarh. We have got two of our colleagues at PGI Chandigarh, Dr. Prashant Sharma, whom we know from, many years. He's additional professor in heme pathology at PGI. We also have Dr. Ashish Jain, who is additional professor in the Department of Transfusion Medicine at PGI Chandigarh. Dr. Prashant Chavda, who's a DM fellow at PGI, is going to present the cases. So the format is as usual that we have been following. So there'll be didactic, which Dr. Richa will be taking at the beginning. And then we'll have case discussions with input from all the faculty. Prashant is going to present those cases in the second half. So thank you very much, Richa and colleagues from PGI for taking today's session. And now want you to take over the session and start the presentation. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Senegal, for inviting us to take this session. For everybody who is attending, thank you for sparing your time. And I would like to say that we have made a slight change in the program. We thought that rather than having an upfront didactic session, it would fit better if we intersperse it along with the case beginnings.
That should be perfectly fine.
So I will request my post-DM senior resident, Dr. Prashant, to start presenting the case beginnings. And along with that, we will have discussion with the cases. So looking forward to everybody's participation. Over to you, Prashant. Thank you.
Right. Thank you very much, Richa ma'am. So thank you, everyone. So good evening, everyone. So I'll start with the case presentation upfront, and then we'll go on to discuss autoimmune hemolytic anemia in between the cases. So the objectives of today's talk would be case-based discussion of autoimmune hemolytic anemia in children, how to approach a case of hemolytic anemia, and then the diagnosis and management of autoimmune hemolytic anemia per se. So for the first case, we have Master V. He is an 11 years old male child who came to PGI with chief complaints of yellowish discoloration of eyes for 1 week and pallor for 3 days. So coming to history of present illness, he had jaundice, which was acute in onset, progressive for 7 days. It was not associated with high colored urine, cola colored urine, or pale colored stools. And he also had a history of pallor for 3 days, which was acute in onset, progressive, and it was associated with easy fatigability, and there was no difficulty in breathing. It was associated with difficulty in breathing. So difficulty in breathing was also acute in onset for 3 days, and it aggravated on walking and relieved on rest, and there was no diurnal or postural variation. So there was no history of any fever, joint pain, rash, abdominal pain or distension. There was no history of any bleeding manifestations, no history of swelling, no history of any cough, cold associated symptoms, chest pain, decreased urine output, swelling of legs. There was no history of loose stools or vomiting, no history of any weight loss or loss of appetite. And there was neither any history of blood transfusions in the past or any drug intake. So in the treatment history, he was referred to us at a hemoglobin of 4 g/dL, and there was no past history of transfusions. And the birth history was uneventful. He didn't require any exchange transfusion or phototherapy during the neonatal period. Developmental history, immunization, and family history, all immunization history were normal. And family history, his mother is a known case of lupus nephritis, which was diagnosed in 2003 at PGI, and currently she was in remission. And there was no history of any transfusions, gallstones, or splenectomy in the family. So he was first born out of a non-consanguineous marriage. So on general examination, the child was having moderate pallor, moderate to severe pallor and icterus, and there was no clubbing, cyanosis, lymphadenopathy, or edema. His vitals were stable, and anthropometrically he was preserved. And in the systemic examination, in abdomen, his liver was palpable 2 cm below the right costal margin with a span of 10 cm, and spleen was palpable, also palpable 2 cm below the left costal margin. Rest of the systemic examination was essentially normal. So with this, we have a database of an 11-year-old male child with yellowish discoloration of eyes, which is acute in onset with associated with progressive pallor, which is just of 3 days history, associated with fatigue and respiratory distress. On examination, he's having pallor, icterus, and hepatosplenomegaly. So possibly with this constellation of symptoms and sign, with jaundice, pallor, we are most likely dealing with a hemolytic anemia. So whenever we encounter such a clinical situation that a child is presenting to us with pallor and jaundice, in the hemolytic anemia, we have a long list of hemolytic anemias with us. So how to proceed and differentiate what it is. So coming to them one by one, it is unlikely to be a hereditary cause, because this is the first event, and without any preceding history of jaundice in the past, no history of any neonatal jaundice. So unlikely to be a hemoglobin enzyme disorders and membrane disorders. He didn't have any transfusions in the past. So, and in the acquired causes of hemolytic anemias, we have immune as well as non-immune causes. So non-immune causes also are unlikely in this child because of the lack of a proper background clinical setting. He's not having any fever or like other causes which are listed, hypersplenism, DIC. Obviously, clinically, it doesn't qualify for any of these. So what we are left with, either autoimmune or alloimmune causes, that is immune causes of acquired hemolytic anemias, but alloimmune causes also, they require a proper clinical setting, that is post-transplant or a recent transfusion, which the child did not have in the past. So it's very likely that we are dealing here with an autoimmune hemolytic anemia with a very precipitous fall of hemoglobin within a 3 days and short span history of jaundice of 7 days. Other differentials that merit discussion in this child clinically with this pallor and jaundice would be acute viral hepatitis, although we can rule out safely because there is no prodrome or fever in this child. Wilson's disease, because the child is having jaundice, but again, this is first event at 11 years of age, very short history without any preceding history of jaundice. Plus in the lab, also lab workup will also tell us whether it is unconjugated or conjugated hyperbilirubinemia. And acute leukemia can also be ruled out clinically because he's not having any clinical stigmata of in bone marrow infiltrative disorders like bone pains or hepatosplenomegaly bone pains. So how to approach a suspected autoimmune hemolytic anemia? Basically, we have to answer 3 queries. First of all, first question that we have to answer is there hemolysis going on in the body? So for that, there we have supportive laboratory markers with us in the form of rise in the unconjugated bilirubin, increased in the retic count. LDH, generally it is raised, but it may be normal. Haptoglobin is reduced. In the peripheral blood film, we may find spherocytes, agglutination, or polychromasia. And in urinalysis, dipstick may be positive for blood, but in microscopy is negative for red blood cells in intravascular hemolysis. And urine hemosiderin also is a surrogate marker of intravascular hemolysis, which generally comes 1 week after the start of the hemolysis. The second question that we have to answer is the hemolysis autoimmune here? So that question will be answered definitely by the direct agglutination test, which we will subsequently discuss. However, both positivity and negativity of this test have to be read with caution, so which we will discuss. So that is why terms and conditions applied for this test. And if we find that the hemolysis is autoimmune in nature, then what sort of autoimmune hemolytic anemia is there? Is it warm type, cold type, or a mixed type that we have to answer? So if we see like what sort of hemolysis is going on in this child or any other child per se, so there are certain markers, clinical as well as lab, to differentiate between the two. So intravascular, the site of hemolysis is within circulation, and extravascular, it is mainly in the reticular endothelial system with spleen, liver, and bone marrow, which are involved. Jaundice is present in both intra and extravascular, although it is more in cases of extravascular hemolysis. Cola-colored urine history is typical of intravascular hemolysis, indicating that red cells are lysing within the circulation, and it is not present in extravascular cases. It may happen in extravascular whenever there is a mixed type of autoimmune hemolytic anemia. And hemoglobinemia, hemocytinuria, and hemoglobinuria, these are markers of intravascular hemolysis. And typical examples of intravascular hemolysis are infectious, like malaria, G6PD deficiency, microangiopathic hemolytic anemia, and the autoimmune hemolytic anemia in children, which is paroxysmal cold hemoglobinuria. And typical representative examples in children of extravascular hemolysis include thalassemia, hereditary spherocytosis, and warm type of autoimmune hemolytic anemia. And the features which are common to both intra and extravascular hemolysis include rise in the LDH, decrease in haptoglobin, erythroid hyperplasia in the bone marrow, and increase in the reticulocyte count. So coming to investigations of the index child, as we can observe, his hemoglobin at presentation was 5, that is severe pallor. And subsequently during hospital stay, when we initiated therapy and with supportive care, it started increasing. And the TLC and the differential counts were normal, platelet counts were normal. And he had MCV of 122, which is above the normal for age. And reticulocyte counts were 22% initially, and later on also we can appreciate that high reticulocyte count is present in this child. But when we correct them, still they are high. We correct them as per the hematocrit. So after correcting, still the reticulocyte counts were high, that is more than 2, which is indicative of erythroid hyperplasia, and then bone marrow is functioning at supranormal, of the like more than the normal pace. So in the peripheral smear of this child, we had moderate anisopoietic keratocytosis, normocytic to macrocytic and normochromic red cells with macrovellocytes. There were spherocytes seen, which we know that it is typical of immune hemolytic anemias, microcytes, and polychromatophils. And then mild RBC agglutination was seen. And then platelets were adequate in the smear. In the biochemistry, total serum bilirubin was high, and LDH was also 2460, which was high. Plasma hemoglobin was not raised, urine hemoglobin was nil. And when we did direct Coombs test, it was strongly positive for both IgG and C3d. As we can see in this picture, it is DCT done with the gel card technique, which will be elaborated by Dr. Prashant Sharma further. So we can see that IgG was positive, which is 4+. It is the normal, and C3d was also positive, that is 3 positive. So normally sediments at the base, and whenever it rises to the top, it becomes positive. So it is a strong positivity indicating that it is floating at the surface, and C3d is also at the surface, with some of them some of it being in the gel media, also indicating that it is 3 positive. So then we did a workup for secondary autoimmune hemolytic anemia in this child. So infectious workup, HIV and syphilis, like VDRL, was negative. Immunoglobulin profile was normal, and ANA was 2+, speckled, but anti-DS DNA was negative. So indicating that it most likely it is not a, we are not dealing with SLE, because lack of homogeneous pattern of ANA and lack of anti-DS DNA positivity. And subsequently when it was repeated, ANA came out to be negative. So in the diagnosis, we have acute onset pallor, jaundice and hepatosplenomegaly with the low hemoglobin and high retic counts, increased LDH, and peripheral smear is showing spherocytes, polychromasia, and macrovellocytes. And the direct Coombs test is positive for both IgG and C3d at 37 degrees Celsius. So very likely that we are dealing here with autoimmune hemolytic anemia, which is of warm type, because of the positivity of both IgG and C3d, which is likely to be idiopathic. So coming to the discussion of autoimmune hemolytic anemia, it is increased destruction of red blood cells by autoimmune mechanisms, and which is usually mediated by autoantibodies against erythrocyte surface antigens. Which may be specific in some cases, but many a times the antibodies, they are not specific for some antigens, and they are against, like they are pan-sensitive against many of the antigens. The incidence in children, exact incidence is not known, but from the Western Registry data, it is 1 in 80,000 approx, and the median age is nearly 4 years. But infants and toddlers may also be affected. And adolescents, they more likely to have a secondary cause. So it is deemed primary when there is no underlying cause which could be can be identified, and it is secondary when it is secondary to some underlying pathology. So adolescents more likely to have a secondary cause. So coming to the types, the warm antibody autoimmune hemolytic anemia, which comprises majority of the hemolytic anemia, autoimmune hemolytic anemias in children, it comprises of 70 to 75%, which could be primary, which is idiopathic, or secondary. And rest cold antibody autoimmune hemolytic anemia comprises 25 to 30%, which can further be divided into cold agglutinin disease, secondary cold agglutinin syndrome. Basically, both of these are a part of same spectrum, but different different presentation and different age group, rather, and paroxysmal cold hemoglobinuria. And then there is a mixture of both, which is termed as mixed cold and warm autoimmune hemolytic anemia. And then there is a special subset, specific subset, which is DAT negative autoimmune hemolytic anemia, which comprises of nearly around 3 to 5% of autoimmune hemolytic anemias in children, which is rare. So coming to warm autoimmune hemolytic anemia, it is idiopathic in nearly 50% of the cases, and rest 50%, they have some underlying cause which can be identified. So what the underlying causes could be, it is secondary to Hodgkin's lymphoma in children, sometimes ALL, autoimmune diseases like SLE, rheumatoid arthritis, autoimmune hepatitis, specifically giant cell hepatitis in children, and when it is associated with other immune cytopenias like thrombocytopenia or neutropenia, it is deemed as Evans syndrome. And other associated underlying disorders could be autoimmune lymphoproliferative syndrome, common variable immune deficiency, and ovarian dermoid cyst, which is rare, and viral infections, which can also cause warm autoimmune hemolytic anemia. So coming to the pathogenesis, the autoantibodies which are involved are polyclonal, and although they are against a specific antigen on the RBC surface, there is antibody formation, but apart from antibody formation, there are other basic immune mechanisms which also play a pathogenetic role in autoimmune hemolytic anemia. For example, there is disruption of the T regulatory cells. There is dysregulation in the CTLA-4 and PD-1, which has recently been described, and nowadays novel therapies are also coming up for autoimmune hemolytic anemia against these targets. And essentially, in the T cell system, it is the disruption of TH1 and TH2 balance which leads to autoimmune hemolytic anemia, apart from the normal antibodies. So if we talk about autoantibody classes, IgG is the most common variety in warm autoimmune hemolytic anemia. However, it can be combination of IgG and IgM as well, and rarely it can be IgM alone, or IgG plus IgA and IgA alone. So all of these which are listed down are very rare. So before proceeding further, because complements, they play a major role in inducing hemolysis in the RBCs, let us just have an overlook at the cascade, complement cascade overview. So what we can see here is there is classical pathway and there is alternative pathway. So the initiating complexes C1Q, which gets deposited on the surface of any RBC, whenever there is antigen-antibody interaction on the surface of RBC, this C1Q gets deposited along with it. And then it subsequently activates the C3, which becomes the C3 convertase. Further activating this, C3A becomes C3B, which is the culprit molecule. And the C3B gets deposited on the RBC surface, which can either induce opsonization and phagocytosis, thus inducing the extravascular hemolysis, or it can, if potentially, if enough in quantity, it can potentially activate the further downstream cascade of complement, that is further activation of all the terminal complement C6 to C9, which induces hemolysis in circulation itself. So whatever the pathway is, be it classical or alternative, both of them converge onto the C3B, which further leads to either extravascular hemolysis or intravascular hemolysis. And then the C3B molecule further gets degraded to C3D, which we detect through direct agglutination test. So basically, it's a footprint of that C3B, which is deposited on the RBC surface. So coming to pathogenesis of warm autoimmune hemolytic anemia per se, like I already discussed, so this is IgG most common, which activates the complement cascade, and then C3B gets deposited on the RBC surface. And then this is opsonized, and it is phagocytosis. cytosed by the macrophages in the liver, mainly Kupffer cells in the liver, which leads to extravascular hemolysis, as well as this antibody itself may lead to phagocytosis in the splenic macrophages. So the cells which escape through this spleen safely without getting demised, they become spherocytes. This is known as splenic conditioning. So they become spherocytes and then they come into the circulation, which are detected in the peripheral blood film. And if the complement quantity is sufficient enough, then it can also induce the intravascular lysis itself by activating the terminal membrane attack complex. So at this point, I would like to ask Dr. Prashant Sharma, sir. So how would you approach this case, like suspected autoimmune hemolytic anemia, with laboratory wise?
Thanks, Prashant. So the lab approach to a suspected case of AIHA, as already told by Dr. Chhabra, a lot of it depends on the context in which we are, in which the laboratory is receiving the sample. So the basic questions we assume have already been answered at the clinical end of and by other investigations of, is there hemolysis? If the hemolysis is there, then we need to work that patient up for immune hemolysis. The specificity of the antibody in most cases can be determined fairly easily. And if we happen to have a cold autoantibody, then what is its titer? So these are the basic steps through which the lab diagnosis progresses. And if you can now turn your attention to the table here, once we've diagnosed hemolysis by LDH, bilirubin, haptoglobin, retic, and of course the peripheral smear heads, we'll get spherocytes, polychromasia, and nucleated RBCs. We're sure that it's a hemolytic anemia. Then the key test in this entity is the direct antiglobulin test. If the DAT is positive, then we're reasonably sure that this is AIHA. There's some caveats that will come to very shortly. At this point, we need to go in for a monospecific DAT. So you need to be aware if the lab that's given you the DAT report, has it done it using a polyspecific serum or a monospecific serum. Once we've done the DAT, which has specific columns for C3d and IgG, we will be able to classify our AIHA. As long as it's IgG positive, especially in titer, grades of 3+ and 4+, we're dealing with a warm antibody type of AIHA. On the other hand, if C3d is positive, IgG may or may not be positive along with it. So in that case, it could still be a warm or cold, and we need to go in for a cold agglutinin titer, unless, and here things become a little dependent on your clinical picture, and you already have a child who's presenting in winter and who's got acrocyanosis. Basically, if your clinical picture is consistent with a cold autoantibody, then you don't need to go in for the cold agglutinin titer unless maybe you're trying to monitor treatment. At this point, we need to let you know that PCH is, although the autoantibody in paroxysmal cold hemoglobinuria is going to be an IgG antibody, but most of the, virtually all the testing is initially done at room temperature. So it's going to show up as C3b positive and IgG negative. Very frequently, PCH can also be IgG negative as well. The DCT can come back normal. But we'll come to that later because Dr. Prashant has a case about it. So if the cold agglutinin titer is of a low titer, then one must, and IgG and C3d are both positive, we'll still consider it as a warm antibody type. In both these situations, we would need to decide whether it's a primary or a secondary. And that, of course, the other investigations in the clinical background are going to tell us. Yeah.
So further to ask you, like, what are the differences between direct and indirect Coombs test and how it is relevant in autoimmune hemolytic anemias? What are the causes of false positive and false negative direct Coombs test? And what are the precautions that one should take while sending samples for direct Coombs test to the laboratory?
So the direct Coombs test forms the cornerstone of diagnosis of AIHA. It's also known as a direct antiglobulin test. So these terms are synonymous and one should not get confused. So in the picture on the left, one can see the red cells. And in AIHA, they're going to be coated mostly with IgG, but also sometimes with C3b. And Dr. Prashant just told us that these are either the opsonins or the result of the opsonization and complement activation, that's the evidence on them. So in this test, we add an anti-serum, which is actually an anti-human globulin, because the antibodies, the blue ones labeled anti-serum, are labeled against human antibodies. once they are binding to the red cells, they can overcome the zeta potential and cause agglutination. That's because IgG per se cannot cause agglutination. It's usually present as a dimer. Because we can detect this agglutination in multiple ways. The conventional way used to be a tube test or a slide-based test, but virtually all advanced labs nowadays would be using a gel card, and that's shown in the pictures on the right. The gel cards can be graded, and that the 4+ to negative grades that you can see on the top right panel is what the report will read. And that's classified based on the location of the red cells. We've already seen an example of an IgG positive and a C3D positive pattern in this talk. So based on that, we will be classifying that as warm or a cold autoantibody types. So our IgG are typically associated with warm autoimmune hemolytic anemia and C3D with a cold. You can get mixed anti-warm and cold types. And in those cases, one would need to be especially vigilant for an underlying secondary cause like SLE or a systemic or another systemic autoimmune disorder. Next, please. On the other hand, the indirect Coombs test is a different game. It detects free antibodies in the serum or plasma. It doesn't detect antibodies coated on the red cell surface. Its clinical utility, as is well known, is to screen for anti-D antibodies in Rh negative mothers and for alloantibody testing in transfusion medicine. But in AIHA, although it's going to be positive in about 20 to 30% of the cases, in virtually all of these, the DAT will also be positive. We do use it if we are wanting to work up, especially a DAT negative AIHA, and we want to know what the autoantibody is directed against, then IAT is the first step of the elution adsorption principle. Next, please. As far as the causes of DAT other than AIHA is concerned, if you're getting a positive DAT, but the clinical context is not adding up, just be careful if the patient's been recently transfused. Could there be an alloantibody that's now forming and now coating the red cell surface, the patient cells? There could be normal globulins that are adsorbing onto the red cell surface as a result of some drugs. But by far the commonest reason for a false positive DAT is positive deposition of antibodies or immune complexes on red cells. And this can happen, as you can see, in a multiple, in a wide array of conditions, and liver disease, chronic infection, malignancy, autoimmune disorders, etc. If you have given a child IVIG or ATG, remember that DAT is almost certainly going to return positive for the next at least a month or so. So it's not going to help you if you think you're having immune hemolysis going on, and in patients with sickle cell disease. So much so that 8% of in-hospital patients will usually have a weak reaction to anti-C3D, and that's important to bear in mind. Next, please. So a positive DAT needs to be interpreted only in the context of the positive markers for hemolysis. Next, please. That was a question that, what if it's a false negative? Of course, it does happen. It was commoner in the days when we relied on the tube technique. But now, since we're using gel cards and the reagent there is less, the false negativity rate is less than 5%. This happens if you have a low affinity antibody. It got washed off in the red cell washings during the tube technique. Gel cards don't require red cell washing. Or we're looking for the wrong antibody. It's an IgM or an IgA. And as you can see from the percentage, they are not insignificant if you've seen the large volume of patients. Next, please. And finally, so how do you go about detecting these patients with negative DAT? You need to exclude alternative causes of hemolysis. Don't just jump to the rare possibility of a DAT negative AIHA. A more sensitive technique like flow can be used, but flow then goes overboard on the other side, that it has probably a relatively high non-specificity as well. So one needs to be, again, be very careful of the context in which a flow positive AIHA is diagnosed. And frankly, in reality, an empirical therapeutic trial is probably what clinches the diagnosis in most cases. Next, please. Rarely one can have reticulocytopenia in AIHA. This is not common at all. This could be because, especially in adults, if there's a lymphoproliferative disorder in the marrow, if it's a AIHA which is very long-standing and the patient's now got a parvovirus B19 infection. Occasionally, if the antibody is directed against either reticulocytes or late normoblasts, then this can happen. Or if the marrow is deficient in some nutrients and is unable to respond because of, say, concomitant iron deficiency and things like that. Thanks.
Thank you, sir. So coming to the management of warm autoimmune hemolytic anemia, it is basically three-pronged management comprising first of all transfusions in the emergency setup when there is hemodynamic compromise in the child coming to the emergency room. The second prong is pharmacotherapy, which we will discuss, and the third one is supportive care. So here I would like to ask Dr. Ashish from Transfusion Medicine, sir, what is the criteria for selection of packed red blood cell units for transfusion in such children?
Thank you, Prashant. Actually, in cases of AIHA, it has to be a very balanced decision between the clinical condition of the patient and keeping in view the laboratory findings for the serological workup. So often we come across these requisitions where AIHA compatibility testing is done. The result is most of the time highly incompatible blood units. No matter it is ABO identical, RH, even across the group, you take any random units, it will turn out to be incompatible. It's mostly because these autoantibodies, even if they are warm, cold, or mixed, they usually have an ill-defined specificities, or even if it is defined, it is through a high-frequency antigen. Like you can say, for example, if it is against a small RHE antigen, then if we look at our population frequency, the possibility of finding an E antigen on a red cell donor unit is more than 98%. So it's a very high frequency. So even in those cases, if you go for even 100, 200 units compatibility testing, it won't solve the purpose. So we have to take a very pragmatic approach where you can just narrow down to the best match you can give to the patient. So for that approach, you need to have a facility of extended phenotyping for various clinically significant red cell antigens. So if we see practically, the most important ones are the extended RH phenotypes, that is the capital C, small c, capital E, and small e antigens, and the Kell blood group system, because the antibodies against these blood group systems are usually IgG type, and they have capability to cause hemolytic transfusion reactions. If not immediate, but definitely they can cause delayed HTRs. So they are clinically significant. So if we have a patient where you find these autoantibodies on testing, and if they are warm reactive or even if they are mixed, so what approach you can take is, like, if the patient is non-transfused, like in this patient, there was no history of past transfusion. So it was a good opportunity. So you phenotype the patient completely. And even if you do a match only for these five antigens, but you can phenotype his complete red cell antigen profile, keeping in mind the extended RH, Kell, this JKA stands for KDA. So again, it is an important clinically significant antigen. FYA stands for Duffy. So Duffy A and Duffy B, and the capital S and small s. So these five blood group systems are the major contributors to clinically significant antibodies. So if you can have an opportunity to phenotype the patient, so this will give you an advantage for subsequent transfusions also. Suppose if you, at one time you give him an extended RH and Kell matched blood unit or red cell unit, then if the patient requires transfusion at some further point of time, then I think many studies are there where these autoantibodies in patients are observed, they are also like have a propensity to form alloantibodies. And the literature says that the frequency could be from 15% to 40%. Even we have observed many patients who have autoantibodies as well as alloantibodies. So like in for future transfusion also, you have a matched profile left with you. So anytime whenever he comes for future transfusion, you can just give the, besides RH and Kell, you can go for an antibody screen and check for the antibodies if they are any. If they are there, you can give them the corresponding antigen match pack. But unfortunately, this facility, I think if we talk in larger sense, it's just available in tertiary care centers only. And if we look at the transfusion services across the country, there's a wide gap in the approach and facilities available with the blood bank. So even like at few places, they don't have a facility of complete AAG cross match. they are just resorting to tube technique and just giving a spin technique cross matching. And you'll find this, such kind of histories in such patients, because when they just land up in severe anemia, they go to district hospital. And what they do just immediately is to transfuse a 1 or 2 units of blood, which was never completely matched. So this is the biggest problem with us when we face such requisitions. So if you have an opportunity, you can give a prophylactic antigen matched donor unit. This will assure that at least you won't have any risk of, or a minimal risk of, hemolytic transfusion reaction. Now, if you look for, to other scenario where the patient has received multiple units, like a recent transfusion within less than 3 months, or if he has some underlying yellow antibodies which were not detected or resolved serologically, then if you look globally, then you can go for genotyping also. But this is a very routine technique, and this is largely done for studying the allelic variation in various blood group systems. So that even if you go for that, it may not help you. So the constraints are the time, the limited availability, and sometimes cost also. So what we have to do is you have to take a very integrated approach between the clinical situation and the serological findings. So if the transfusion is actually required, like if the hemoglobin is very low, like 3-4 grams, then definitely patient requires transfusion. Then you have to corroborate with the serological findings. And besides giving the best match, we have to just keep a balance between compatibility testing and this antigen matching. So this assures you a very balanced approach, and the risk of HTRs is minimized in such cases. Although it means like that may or may not be positive, most of the time it is positive, but the severity or the strength of that or strength of incompatibility in vitro cannot be translated to the in vivo survival of red cells. So it's most of the time unpredictable. So what we do is we always go for a unit which is like a very optimal volume, and it's better to dose the unit. Like the standard dosing is 10 to 15 ml per kg of the patient's body weight. Like it's a very standard practice in pediatric setup. So in such cases, if the patient's age is very low, is like less than a year or so, you can even go for pediatric units. So again, if you have facility, you can go for pedivacs. So transfuse only the amount which is actually required to achieve the clinical benefit, and give it under a very close supervision. So this is what is recommended. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir, for elucidating the on transfusional aspects. So now I'd like to ask Dr. Richa Jain, ma'am, what should be the definitive therapy for these children with warm autoimmune hemolytic anemia, and how to monitor both clinical and the lab aspects?
Thank you, Prashant. So let me first come, can I have the next slide? Yes. So let us first look at this child who is presented to emergency with a severe anemia, hemoglobin of 4. So I think the most important concern for the emergency physician or any clinician who is taking care of this child would be whether I should transfuse this patient or not. We send the sample across to the blood bank, and we hear from the blood bank typically that, oh, we are having a lot of problems in cross-matching this unit. We are suspecting strongly that the patient may be having some kind of autoimmune hemolysis. Please send us more sample. So the moment the physician hears the word autoimmune hemolysis, we are scared that if we give some more blood, there will be worsening of lysis. We might be looking at a rapid drop of hemoglobin. We might be looking at renal dysfunction because of the rapid hemolysis that is happening. So indication and decision for blood transfusion is not to be taken lightly in these patients. However, that said, any child who has severe anemia, any child who has active hemodynamic compromise or a potential to develop hemodynamic compromise, we should not withhold the blood transfusion for fear of aggravating and worsening the hemolysis, because in itself, this kind of a rapid fall in hemoglobin is life-threatening and can lead to demise of the child. So severe anemia, hemodynamic compromise, rapidly falling hemoglobin, anticipating a hemodynamic compromise in the near future are all reasons to give blood to the child. Clinically, typically, if a child has a hemoglobin of more than 6, we can probably wait, especially if the child is otherwise hemodynamically stable without any comorbidity. We can give a trial of steroid, wait for 24 hours, 48 hours, see how the child is doing, and if the hemolysis is stabilizing. If a child has a hemoglobin of less than 5, in all likelihood, the child will end up requiring a blood transfusion. So Dr. Ashish has already told us in detail that how the blood bank gives us the least incompatible blood unit after thorough testing and an extended testing. Washed RBCs are preferred. In addition, folic acid supplementation is typically given to these children because the bone marrow is working very hard and there is a lot of erythropoiesis going on. So the supplementation is required. Coming to the specific therapy, the definitive therapy for these patients. So for a warm AIHA, by far the first line of therapy is steroids. Oral steroids and intravenous steroids typically work equivalent. So prednisolone or a prednisolone equivalent of 2 to 6 milligrams per kg. Typically the dose we start at is 2 milligrams per kg in 2 to 3 divided doses. Sometimes children who have ongoing severe hemolysis, no response in the next 24 hours with severe rapid drops in hemoglobin would require a higher dose. And in practice, we give doses up to 4 milligrams per kg, though doses even up to 6, 8 and 10 milligram have been described in literature. An alternative drug that can be used is methylprednisolone intravenous, doses of up to 2 milligrams per kg per day in 4 divided doses for a period of 3 days before switching to an oral steroid like prednisolone. However, mega dose of methylprednisolone again has also been used, and we have also used clinically in children who have severe hemolysis, which is uncontrolled on the lower doses of prednisolone or methylprednisolone. So these are to be used sparingly and only in very specific clinical contexts. Monitoring, obviously clinical thorough monitoring is required, hemodynamic development of worsening of pallor, development or evolution of congestive cardiac failure, whether the urine output is maintained or not, because hemolysis can decrease the urine output, and whether the child remains well hydrated or not. The laboratory monitoring that we do typically is initially the hemoglobin is monitored every 12 to 24 hourly. Reticulocyte count is especially helpful in deciding the response to therapy. And in children who have ongoing severe hemolysis, ongoing hemolysis which is not responding, direct Coombs test monitoring is done intermittently at 3 to 4 to 7 days interval to see whether we are seeing a decrease in the positivity of direct Coombs test that might help us decide at times whether our therapy is working or not. So typically in a child with warm autoimmune antibody, the initial response to steroid is about 80%. So you will note that the hemoglobin starts stabilizing within 1 to 3 days of starting of steroids. The rapid crash stops, slight buildup happens, which happened in this particular child also. If we see his hemograms, his HP stabilized at around 6 to 7 gram per deciliter after a period of about 24 to 48 hours of oral steroids. However, warm AIHA has a typically waxing and a waning kind of a course, and children may often have recurrence. So a durable remission with the initial steroid therapy is seen in about 20 to 40% children only. So next, please. Some children go on to require second line therapy. This second line therapy may either be a rescue therapy or it may be given for a resistant disease. When I talk about rescue therapy is given initially at a point when there is active severe hemolysis beyond the initial 2 to 3 days of hospital admission. So at times you have children who have a very bad AIHA, their hemoglobin drops repeatedly to below 3 to 4 gram per deciliter, leading to impending CCF. And despite high doses of steroids, when these children do not respond, we have to resort to rescue therapy. Another reason for giving second line therapy is non-response, which may be defined variably as ongoing active hemolysis after about 3 to 4 weeks of good doses of steroids, or HB, which is persisting to be below 10 grams per deciliter despite good doses of steroids after about 3 weeks. So, and another reason to give second line therapy, of course, would be steroid dependence or during or after steroid reduction. So the first therapy that most people try, and the best therapy to try after steroids is IVIG. The dose is typically 2 g/kg. It may be given as 1 g/kg over 2 days. It might be given as 0.5 mg/kg over a period of 4 to 5 days. Rituximab can also be attempted in these children with warm AIHA. The response is not as good as the steroid responses, but still it's a good drug to give in children who are refractory or having persistent severe hemolysis despite the first two lines of therapy, that is the steroids and IVIG. Plasmapheresis is less helpful in a warm AIHA. However, there are anecdotal records, and it is to be done kind of when you do not have, when you have failed other options. Similarly, emergency splenectomy, partial splenic embolization, while described, are clinically done practically never. It's really a last resort measure because it's a very permanent kind of a thing. So next slide, please. Over to you.
Yeah, so coming back to the course of the index child, Master V, he had hemoglobin of 5 at presentation. So he was transfused with least incompatible blood under steroid cover on day 2 of admission. And he was started on oral prednisolone at 2 mg/kg per day, simultaneously with folic acid. And after 2 weeks, the prednisolone was tapered to 1.5 mg/kg per day. And these are the serial hemograms, hemoglobin of 5 at presentation. And then thereafter, it started a rise. The MCV remained the same, and retic count remained in the range of 20 to 25%. Right. So the plan for index child was slow tapering of the steroids over a period of 3 to 6 months. So whenever we taper steroids, we have to do it very slowly so as to avoid the relapse. As Dr. Richa already told, that 20 to 40% have a relapse. Simultaneously, we have to do hemoglobin and retic count monitoring and then watch for relapse or recurrence. So coming to the next case, we have an infant, 4 months old female child who is having progressive pallor for 20 days, respiratory distress for 5 days with associated suck rest suck cycle with interrupted feeding and history of yellow orange discoloration of urine. There is no history of any bleeding manifestations, yellow discoloration of eyes or fever. And there was history of blood transfusion 6 days back prior to coming to PGI. So in history, the antenatal, perinatal, and family history were uneventful. She was exclusively breastfed and immunized for the age. And on examination, anthropometrically, she was preserved, vitals were stable, and she was, however, she was having severe pallor and icterus. There was no purpura, edema, or lymphadenopathy, and both liver and spleen were palpable, 3 cm below the costal margins. So in the database, we have a 4-month-old baby girl with acute illness of pallor, congestive cardiac failure, icterus, and hepatosplenomegaly. And so possibly here also we are looking at hemolytic anemia, which is immune in origin, or it could be thalassemia major presenting at this age with low hemoglobin and hepatosplenomegaly, or it could be secondary to G6PD deficiency causing hemolysis. Although there was no history of any suggestive of any intravascular hemolysis in this child. So she came to us with a hemoglobin of 2.3. RBC count was low, MCV was high, 109. TLC-DLC and platelets were normal, and reticulocyte count was 8.9%. And bilirubin was high at 4.9. In the investigations, B12 and folate levels were normal. Ferritin, HPLC, G6PD, and urine hemoglobin, plasma hemoglobin all were normal. So in the peripheral smear, she also had few macrocytes, spherocytes, and polychromasia. So this was the direct antiglobulin test, which was done at the Department of Transfusion Medicine for this child, which was showing a blood group of B positive, and there was autoantibodies positive. So in the DAT, we can see it was positive for anti-IgG on 2 different occasions. One was 4 positive and one was 3 positive. And so we did the secondary workup for autoimmune hemolytic anemia. The parvovirus serology was negative. EBV and mycoplasma serology was negative. And the lymphocyte subset and double negative T cells were normal. And immunoglobulin profile was normal. So I would like to ask now Dr. Ashish, what are the problems, sir, encountered during pre-transfusion testing and their resolution in cases of autoimmune hemolytic anemia? And how do we detect any underlying red cell alloantibodies?
Thank you, Prashant. So like in such cases, the most important thing is the resolution of serological testing. So first, whenever we receive requisitions for these patients, the most important step is assigning proper blood group to the patient, because we have come across situations where patients have transfused in the peripheral district hospital. They were transfused AB positive. Thus, the principle behind this finding is very simple. Because of the autoantibodies, most of the people, if they don't do serological testing in a systematic manner, they end up assigning blood group AB positive to the patient, because every reagent you add to the red cell, that will give rise to agglutination. So first important step in suspected cases of autoimmune hemolytic anemia is to assign the blood group properly by doing a forward blood grouping and a reverse blood group. So forward blood grouping has four components. You just try to identify the antigen present on the red cell by using monoclonal anti-sera, which is anti-A, anti-B, anti-D, and anti-AB. So if there is no discrepancy in this, that means most likely your group is killed. But you need to have a corroborative evidence of the simultaneous presence of the expected antibody. So like if you look at the forward blood grouping of this patient, the anti-B is reacting and anti-D is reacting, as well as anti-AB. So the forward blood grouping is suggestive of BRSD positive. Now, if an individual is BRSD positive, he or she should bear anti-A antibody in his plasma and serum and not any other antibody. But there are exceptions to this finding, like in neonates or sometimes of infants up to 3 to 6 months of life, because the passively acquired antibodies from the maternal circulation, they may still persist. So that's why if you see closely, we have this child's age was 4 months. So we had asked for the mother sample also for further workup. So this is our universal policy. Any child requisition, irrespective of the diagnosis, we also ask for a mother sample, specifically up to 3 months of age, but better if it is up to 6 months age also, because there could be some underlying maternally acquired passive antibodies. So here in this case, fortunately, we didn't have any problem with the blood grouping. So blood group was very clear. However, with the auto control, that means the patient's own cells with his own serum, and the auto control was positive. So there was obvious autoantibodies, and they were reactive at room temperature as well as in AGP. So they were clinically significant. AG, as Dr. Prashant has earlier told, is anti-human globulin. So it is like largely indicative of IgG type of antibody. So it was positive with gel as well as tube technique. So everything was positive. So we did that also, that is direct Coombs test, and possibility of underlying antibody screening. So one reason was because of that maternally acquired antibodies. And another reason was for this previous transfusion history, because this child has received transfusion 6 days back before coming to us. So there could be a possibility, although this is a very short time period to give rise to any immune response for a child of this age, but it's still like we didn't want to take any chance with compatibility testing. So as you can see, the dad was positive for IgG, and that was on two occasions. However, the strength was slightly variable. So 3+, 4+ are considered as quite strongly positive. But if we look at the antibody screening, that means screening for other red cell antibodies against other clinically significant antigens like RHKL, WKD, MNS. So against these blood group system antigens. So everything was positive. So that means now you cannot narrow down to any specific antibody. So it could be against any of these antigens. So you can't just narrow down your possibility. So this was a big challenge. So in that case, you have to then again adapt to a very pragmatic approach. You have to keep a balance between incompatibility, antibody screening, and the unit you are selecting. So the unit you are selecting for transfusion should be least incompatible, but this what should be the benchmark for this least incompatible? So in practical sense, it should be a weakly reactive as against your auto control. So like your auto control is 2+ reactive, So you can select an incompatible unit which is 1 plus or less. So that would be considered as a safest unit. Next slide,
please. Dr. Ashish, can I please request you to be a bit brief? We have a few more slides.
Yeah, sure.
Thank you.
So as I have already told, we come across three situations where grouping is a problem, compatibility is a problem, and we have to characterize autoantibodies. So for grouping, I've already told that we come across this mixed field and unexpected antibodies. So at times, using warm saline washes may resolve many things, especially your cold agglutinins will disappear. Then you put an auto control at various temperatures. You do a compatibility testing using the most suitable or most validated method. So here we use mostly gel technique, and we use a best match or least incompatible. Another important thing is you can at times be able to characterize the autoantibody. You can do an elution of that positive RBCs, but again, this is a very cumbersome procedure and not sensitive enough. And with that elute, what will happen is your antibodies will get detached from the specifically bound RBC surface antigens, and you can further characterize those antibodies. But the most important thing is the thermal amplitude of antibody. They are reactive up to AHG phase of testing. They are clinically significant. Then even if they are IgM or IgG, that doesn't matter a lot. And even their titers doesn't matter a lot if they are widely reactive. Next, please. So this is one of the methods where if you are suspecting underlying red cell antibodies, you can go for an autologous adsorption or an allogenic adsorption. So autologous adsorption can only be done in non-transfused patients. So what you do is simply allow the red cells and serum to adsorb or to be in contact with each other at different temperatures. So what will happen is the specific antibodies will get adsorbed to the red cell, and the remaining sera can then be used for testing other ABO antibodies which are besides ABO blood group system. But if the patient is recently transfused, you can use some other allogenic red cells, but that again is a very tedious process. Then obviously these two methods of antibody screening and antibody identification are the most standard ones, where you have a panel of red cells. This is a 3-cell panel. I think in the next slide it's an 11-cell panel. So you react with these wide variety of red cells. The patient sera is reacted to these red cells. And depending on the results of each of these individual panels, you can narrow down the possibility of your red cell alloantibodies. And then you try to give the best match blood for which the patient is bearing any antibody, you give an antigen negative corresponding red cell. This is the most practical approach we can adapt in such. Thank you.
Prashant, you're muted.
So coming back to the course of Miss A, initially her hemoglobin was 2.3, and later on she required blood transfusion. The frequency of blood transfusion increased, and it requiring every alternate days. Retic counts were also high throughout the hospital stay. So initially she was started on prednisolone at 2 mg/kg. However, because of the lack of rise in hemoglobin and needing PRBC transfusion requirements, she was given rescue therapy with IVIG with 1 g/kg, and it was repeated after 10 days. She still didn't respond. So we went ahead with bone marrow, which was showing erythroid hyperplasia with 5% dyserythropoiesis and 2% ring sideroblast. And thereafter, she was started on rituximab. So in total, she received 6 doses of rituximab. She didn't have any response till 4th dose of rituximab, and the transfusion frequency remained very high with a high retic count. And only after 6th dose, 1 week after the last dose of rituximab, she started to have a hemoglobin rise. And then it was a sustained rise to a peak hemoglobin of 14.8, which was 3 months post last dose of rituximab dose. And then steroids were gradually tapered and stopped. So here I would like to ask Dr. Richa Jain, what is the role of rituximab in upfront management of autoimmune hemolytic anemia and as second line? And what are the other options for second line management of these children?
Thank you, Professor. So rituximab is used very frequently in adult AIHA, but in pediatric AIHA, there is no role upfront of adding rituximab to steroids if a child is otherwise well. So practically all children improve with steroids. Very few children go on to require rituximab. Rituximab is used only when there is failure of the first two first line options, which are steroids and IVIG, as I mentioned earlier, and it is the next treatment of choice. So it is effectively the second line treatment of choice. And the other second line treatment that we know of is splenectomy, which used to be used very frequently in the past. However, splenectomy is a much more permanent kind of a treatment and has several side effects, including long-term side effects. So rituximab is preferred as the second line therapy of choice over splenectomy. So the response rate after starting rituximab is about 60 to 85%. Next, please. So the doses that can be used are 375 milligram per meter square is the conventional dose described given every weekly. And however, there is a low fixed dose of 100 milligram, which has been shown to be effective in some series of warm AIHA, which is what we actually used in this child. And she responded after a few doses of rituximab. If you also see in this child, the direct Coombs test that Dr. Ashish was discussing, it was done at two points of time. That was done to assess the response in the severe case of AIHA. The initial DAT was 4 positive. The second DAT also was 3 positive, demonstrating that severe hemolysis was still continued. So next, please. So I think I've already mentioned, and I'll be very brief here, that rituximab versus splenectomy, rituximab is definitely to be preferred because splenectomy has a lot of long-term side effects, including the risk of thrombosis. I think I'll not go further into it. Next slide, please. So just looking at this comparison between rituximab and splenectomy, so the response rates are reasonably similar, 80% in rituximab initially and 60 to 70% in splenectomy. The onset of action with rituximab is 3 to 6 weeks. That onset of action with splenectomy is nearly immediate. Relapses are seen in rituximab in 25 to 50% of the children and in splenectomy in 30% of the children. The biggest advantage of rituximab is that it is non-invasive and splenectomy is much more permanent kind of a thing with the risk of opsy and thrombosis, though it's easier to do than to give rituximab in certain options, especially where there are cost concerns. Another major side effect of rituximab is that it may induce severe hypogammaglobulinemia in these children, and often these children require IVIG replacement therapy. This child also went on to require IVIG replacement therapy for quite a while. So the good thing is that the long-term remission rate with rituximab is better than that of splenectomy. So I would like to kind of summarize the role of rituximab as saying no role upfront. It is a role only as a second-line rescue or in a refractory kind of an AIHA. And in that situation, it is the preferred second line agent of choice. The other thing is that rituximab often is the first line therapy in severe cold autoimmune hemolytic anemias. Next, please. So while we are talking of refractory AIHAs, just let us take a look at the alternative options once we have failed the first line and the second line. So there are multiple drugs which are mentioned as a third line therapy. For the last few years, mycophenolate, mofetil, and tacrolimus have taken over as the preferred third-line agents of choice, and that is because a lot of children who have secondary AIHA, about 50% of the children will end up having secondary AIHA, like Prashant mentioned. Some of these children may have underlying ALPS or ALPS-like syndrome, in which case MMF and tacrolimus are very good choices. Of course, there are other drugs. Azathioprine is a drug which is very commonly used in as a third line agent, and it's quite effective in certain children. I think I will not discuss drug therapy any further, and I will give over to you, Prashant, for subsequent. Yeah, we can miss this slide. Yes, for the next case. Thanks.
Right. So, thank you, ma'am. So, moving on to the next case. Case 3 is a Master S who is an 8.5-year-old boy, resident of Haryana. Came to us with short duration history of fever of 7 days and cough of 4 days with a high colored urine of 2 days. So in the history of present illness, he had fever, daily 1 to 2 spikes, maximum 101 degree Fahrenheit, cough was dry, non-paroxysmal, and he was having high colored urine without any association with burning, micturition, or no passage of clots. There was no history of trauma, no history of jaundice, rash, or swelling over body. There was no history of decreased urine output or diarrhea or abdominal pain. So past history, developmental immunization, and family history were all normal. And he was first born out of a non-consanguineous marriage. In the general physical examination, anthropometrically, he was preserved. Normal vitals with pallor. However, there was no icterus or lymphadenopathy. And in the systemic examination, only liver was palpable 2 centimeters below the right costal margin, and spleen was not palpable. So because he was having cough and fever, we got one X-ray done, which was showing this patch in the left lower lobe of the left lower lobe of the lung. And so we started the child on ceftriaxone and azithromycin, considering the possibility of viral induced cold immune hemolytic anemia. And his initial hemogram showed a hemoglobin of 9.9 and 9.5 with TLC of 17,000 and 15,000 with normal neutrophilic leukocytosis. Platelet counts were preserved and ESR was normal. ESR was raised and renal profile was normal. And in the MCV, it was 86.5. MCH was high and MCHC was 105.6. So in the peripheral smear, red cells in this child were showing agglutination pattern. We can appreciate there is clumping of RBCs and platelets were increased. Retic count, however, was 3.12%. LDH was high, 1218, and plasma hemoglobin was not raised. So when we did direct Coombs test for this child, it was positive for C3D and negative for IgG. So only isolated C3D positivity was there in the Coombs. So we kept the possibilities of cold agglutinin disease and paroxysmal cold hemoglobinuria in this child, both of which are variants of cold autoimmune hemolytic anemia. So coming to cold agglutinin syndrome, in this child, when this is smear, which was done at 25 degrees Celsius, and when blood was warmed to 37 degrees Celsius, then we can appreciate that the clumping disappeared. And when we saw the cell counter parameters at room temperature versus warming to 37 degrees Celsius, we can see that initial RBCs were 1.95, which increased to 3.42, and hematocrit was also 17, which increased to 27.1 on warming, possibly as an effect of declumping or deaggregation of the RBCs. So other investigations which were done, blood culture was sterile, hepatitis markers were negative, and IgM EBV VCA antibody was positive in this child, and mycoplasma IgM antibody was also positive. So both of them were positive. And when we did cold agglutinin titers, it was high at 1028. And however, Donath-Landsteiner test was negative, which we'll subsequently cover what are they and how are they done. And so for secondary workup, we did autoimmune workup. C3 and C4 normal. ANA was negative, ANCA was negative, and immunoglobulin profile was normal. So the final diagnosis with a background of fever, cough, with a patch on left side of lung on X-ray, with high mycoplasma titers as well as EBV titers. However, on repeat, that EBV titers declined, and so the final diagnosis was kept at mycoplasma pneumonia with cold agglutinin disease. So he was started on azithromycin for mycoplasma pneumonia. Hemoglobin, only with supportive care, it remained, he did not receive any transfusions, and it did not drop below 6 gram per dL. And he remained supportive. He received supportive care in the form of hydration, avoidance of cold, and warm clothing of exposed parts. So coming to cold hemolytic anemias, the pathogenesis, basically they are cold agglutinin disease and paroxysmal cold hemoglobinuria in children. So here the culprit antibody is either IgM in case of cold agglutinin disease or IgG in PCH. So what this antibody does, whenever blood circulates to a colder area in the body, like lobule of pinna or columella, so this antibody fixes complement at low temperatures, and whenever this blood gets back to the core of the body, to the warmer areas, this antibody gets dissociated. So IgM is the culprit in CAD, which is a pentameric antibody we know, and it typically, because of its pentameric nature, it agglutinates. It causes the RBCs to get closer to each other, and it agglutinates the RBCs. However, in PCH, the culprit antibody is IgG, which is basically a hemolysin. So what it does is it fixes the complement on the surface of RBC to a terminal membrane attack complex, which causes intravascular hemolysis predominantly. So in this picture, we can appreciate the mechanism of IgM, cold agglutinin disease. It has fixed the C3b on the surface of RBC, and this C3b goes to the reticuloendothelial system, Kupffer cells in the liver, and it gets phagocytosed in the liver. So main site of hemolysis in cold agglutinin disease is also liver. But is this C3b can also fix the complement on the surface itself, leading to intravascular hemolysis. So coming to cold autoimmune hemolytic anemia in children, epidemiologically, paroxysmal cold hemoglobinuria is much more common than cold agglutinin syndrome. So up to 40% of childhood autoimmune hemolytic anemia in younger children may have PCH. And basically, it is infectious triggers, which can be a non-specific viral illness like varicella, adenovirus, CMV, Epstein-Barr virus, H influenzae, mycoplasma, measles, or mumps. And it is all the cold autoimmune hemolytic anemias are usually transient and they need supportive care. However, if the disease is severe or persistent, then one may attempt to try steroids. However, the response rate of steroids is not good in cold immune hemolytic anemias. And again, because of the intravascular localization of IgM antibodies, one may attempt plasmapheresis for life-threatening disease, which may temporarily reduce hemolysis. So cold agglutinin disease, it is a separate disease, which is a clonal disease of adults with a distinct bone marrow and flow cytometry results. It is not found in children. The cold agglutinin syndrome, which is present in children, is secondary to some underlying disease, most commonly which is secondary to mycoplasma and Epstein-Barr virus infections. So etiology, most common in children is these two, which I've listed, mycoplasma and Epstein-Barr virus. And the antigen of interest of these antibodies is capital I in case of mycoplasma and small I in case of Epstein-Barr virus. And it can be secondary to other infections, as I already told, and secondary to malignancy in adults and autoimmunity also. So now I would like to ask Dr. Prashant Sharma, sir, how to approach cold autoimmune hemolytic anemia in children in laboratory?
So what we do, Prashant, is it still begins with the direct antiglobulin test. And in this case, we will get a C3d positivity with or without IgG. Of course, if it is with IgG, then one needs to be, like we discussed earlier, make sure that it is not a mixed autoantibody types. At that point, you could go in for an antibody titer, especially if they are mixed types. But most importantly, at that point, we need to look at the clinical picture. Basically, your lab may be dealing with both adults and children. So it's always a good idea to let them know that because this is a child, PCH is a distinct diagnostic consideration here. If they can so the PCH antibody, usually the hemoglobins will be much lower. The patient will have intravascular hemolysis. On the other hand, the cold agglutinin disease or CHAD that you get in the adults, typically they're very self-limiting and the patients come more with acrocyanosis and less severe anemia. Once you've sensitized the lab to that, they can do a Donath-Landsteiner test if that is available. If it's positive, of course, it's clear cut. The DL antibody is notoriously difficult to detect and notoriously frequently falsely negative. So another test that laboratories will frequently do is ask you to send the patient to the lab or send a sample that's been collected in a pre-warmed syringe, in a pre-warmed evacuated tube, to the lab, and then they repeat the testing done under warm conditions. So if at that point of time, when you're testing the sample, you can still show it as being positive, you know that you may be dealing ultimately with a cold hemagglutinin disease only. And the next slide. The other advantage of sampling in the cold is that sometimes the DCT just doesn't work. If our patient's blood is full of red cell agglutinates, then one can see in the gel card below the control column is also coming as positive. This is a negative control, so the cells should have all been at the bottom. So then the interpretation of the positive IgG and C3d becomes very tricky. So this, and the reason is there in the photograph B, which is the red cell agglutinates. You've already nicely shown us a case where the red cell histograms, if you have an abnormally high MCH and MCHC, macrocytosis, of course, is going to be there. But remember, reticulocytes are also slightly larger cells. So especially if you have a macrocytosis of 120 and beyond, and we have a mismatch between hemoglobin and hematocrit. So these are all subtle clues on the CBC that one's dealing with a red cell agglutination. So this artifact also gets avoided when the sample is collected under pre-warmed condition. I forgot, you'd asked me earlier about precautions for the standard DCT. There really aren't much. We just need an EDTA sample. And if it's as is more common, the warm antibody type, then no temperature control is also required. Thanks.
Right. So coming to these two common etiologies in children for cold disease, mycoplasma infectious mononucleosis. Mycoplasma is found in 1/3 of all cold AIH in children. And antibody is anti-I specificity, and it typically occurs 2 to 3 weeks after onset of illness and typically resolves after further 2 to 3 weeks. And the BGH recommendations for treating this mycoplasma-induced hemolysis is just supportive care with appropriate antimicrobials, a warm environment, and transfusion for symptomatic anemia. However, if hemolysis is severe and persistent, then one may consider emergency treatment with steroids or immunoglobulins. Similarly, with Epstein-Barr virus disease induced cold agglutinin syndrome, it typically happens within 1 to 2 weeks of onset of IM. Antibody is anti-small I specificity, and it is clinically it is mononucleosis-like illness with fever, malaise, jaundice, hepatitis pneumomegaly, followed by jaundice, and it is also self-limiting within 4 to 8 weeks. And similarly, these patients can also be monitored for resolution. But if hemolysis is more severe, then one may consider prednisolone. This is from adult recommendation, that is 1 mg per kg per day. But in children, we may go, as told by Dr. Richa also, 2 6 mg per kg per day. And if AIH is due to cold antibody, then patient should avoid cold exposure. So supportive care in cold hemolytic anemia, the bacterial or other febrile illnesses should be treated promptly. Patient should be kept warm, as the colder environment will lead to fixation of antibody-induced complement of the RBC surface. No cold IV fluid should be given, and ideally an inline blood warmer should be used for while transfusing the child with packed cells, and it is usually self-limiting. So coming to pharmacotherapy overview, in desperate situations, one may use steroids in PCH and rituximab, as I already told by Dr. Richa also, that it is also effective therapeutic modality for cold disease as well. However, splenectomy doesn't work because site of hemolysis is not spleen in cases of cold autoimmune hemolytic anemia. And like other agents which may be tried is eculizumab, being in complement C3 inhibitors, and bortezomib, which is a relatively newer therapy. So splenectomy is not beneficial, and steroids, generally they have a poor response of 50 to 35%. So this is just an algorithmic approach. Primary CAD is not a disease of children. It is a disease of adults in which they try rituximab along with other therapies like bendamustine, fludarabine, etc. And secondary CAS, which is secondary to mycoplasma and EBV, we have to treat the underlying infections. So we have one more case, but I can stop here and take up the questions from the audience.
Or we can stop because it's already nearly 7:20, and there are a couple of questions that I can see in the chat box, and then we will see how it goes. Prashant, hello, can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am, I can hear you. Yeah.
So I can see one question which says maximum how long to wait to see for steroid response in warm AIHA or to switch for second line therapy. So Prashant, would you like to answer this?
Right, so as I as you already pointed out, ma'am, so typically steroid response starts occurring in 1 to 3 days. But if the child is having severely low hemoglobin, which is not responding to at least 1 to 3 days requiring PRBC transfusion, so one may switch to second line therapy as a rescue measure, or in cases of relapse, like we have to wait for at least 3 weeks before labeling it that it is a refractory disease in case of non-emergent settings. Then also one may switch to second line therapy.
Right. So if you note in the second case, this child had effectively very poor response. She was refractory eventually, but initially she started as a poor response. She was a 4-month-old girl who had multiple blood transfusion requirement. Her HP kept on dropping every alternate day to 2 to 3 gram despite a transfusion and high dose of steroids that she was getting. So an IVIG was added within the first week. It could even have been added earlier by day 3 or 4. Also, it can be done. So in such a child, definitely as a rescue therapy, rituximab should be considered. So like Prashant says, if within the first 3 to 4 days, good response has not started, ongoing severe hemolysis is there, or beyond 3 to 4 weeks, we are still showing features of ongoing hemolysis. Another reason to give a rescue therapy would be persisting steroid dependence. Like the moment we start to taper steroid, hemolysis resurfaces. So you cannot give such high dose steroids for very long because it has such severe side effects. So if there is persistence of requirement of steroids beyond a period of say 4 to 6 weeks, and anytime you taper, there is ongoing resurfacing of hemolysis, that would be another reason to give a rescue therapy. So again, role of giving together in severe cases, definitely yes, like we did in the second child's. This there are some children, not very many, but yes, there are some children who have bad EIHA and do require multiple therapies, as was required in this child, steroid, IVIG, and rituximab, all were required in her. She had continued on steroids for a very long time. So if we have doubt of sepsis add-on, then TOC, I am not sure what is the full form of TOC. Maybe it can be typed in. Meanwhile, I'll just look at the, treatment of choice. If we have a doubt of sepsis add-on, then what is the treatment of choice? Prashant, would you like to answer this? Most of the queries are clinical, so I'll request Prashant to take this up.
So we have doubt of sepsis, then I think IVIG would be a better modality to add rather than rituximab as a second line therapy.
Right. If we are looking at bacterial sepsis, which is usually uncommon in children with just a plain simple AIHA or a post-infectious AIHA. Typically, the infection leading to AIHA is a viral infection which occurs 2 to 3 weeks preceding the precipitous fall of hemoglobin. So associated bacterial sepsis is very uncommon and we don't really see it very frequently. So most of the times we can start steroids. The condition where there is an associated bacterial sepsis would definitely be infrequent. If there is a strong suspicion, then yes, an alternative like IVIG, Prashant has mentioned, should be attempted. Another question is, in cold AIHA with severe anemia, if there is spontaneous clumping, and sometimes there would be difficulty to do blood grouping, cross-matching to arrange blood, what precautions do we take apart from collecting in pre-warmed syringe? Anything we need to inform blood bank? Dr. Ashish, I think this question would be best taken up by you.
Yeah, actually, this is the real practical problem. So it's very important to inform the transfusion services that clinically you are suspecting some AIHA. Because most of the time what happens is the patient lands up with severe anemia and they just send a requisition for packed cell transfusion indicating just severe anemia. So as I emphasized, there's a wide difference between the transfusion practices across the country. So it's very important to brief them about the clinical situation and just do write that you are suspecting some autoimmune hemolytic anemia. Cold warm may be a second thing of concern, but even if you just flag the case by AIHA, it would be sufficient enough. Second thing is you should emphasize the transfusion services people to do extended cross-matching. See, what happens is, like, it's already a clinical emergency and you don't flag the situation properly. So in such situation, it is a standard operating procedure that you do a spin cross match. So in that spin cross match, you land up even determining the blood group correctly. As I said, like in such cases, even if you send sample in pre-warm syringes, by the time the testing takes place and if the room temperature, and another point is, like, we never know the thermal amplitude of these cold antibodies. Cold doesn't mean that it is only reactive at 4 degrees Celsius. Most of the time they are also reactive at room temperature, that is around 20 degrees C, which is a standard testing temperature or ambient temperature in any laboratory. So they will, again, like, if they warm it, again, it will appear, and this will lead to false grouping. So many times we have also seen that it invariably turns into an AB blood group, which is not true. So you ask for an extended grouping and an extended cross match. And as I said, if facilities are there, you can go for a phenotype match also. But these two bare minimum things, keeping in view the clinical picture and just inform them about the situation you are suspecting.
Right. Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Ashish. So, Dr. Prashant, I would actually like to ask you something. And that is, like, sometimes we get IgG and C3D, both which are positive. In the lab, how do you differentiate whether this is actually a mixed AIHA or just a warm AIHA? Because both can be positive in both.
Yeah. So most of the times, Dr. Richa, the blood film findings are going to give it away fairly reliably. So if you, from the blood film, we're getting spherocytes, nucleated RBCs, but no agglutinates, and the red cell indices can help here if they're also not showing any evidence of red cell agglutination. And if the IgG grade is higher than the C3D grade, then right, in all of these situations, one probably won't think twice. The other scenario is, and this is less common, if it's winter and our child's come with hemolytic anemia, we're getting a C3D, which is 3+ or 4+, and we've got an IgG, which is 1+ or 2+. That luckily happens rarely, but in those situations, if the clinical side is also not extremely sure of what's going on, then we will have to go in for a cold agglutinin titer and see if it's a significantly elevated cold agglutinin or just something which is riding along with a warm AIHA.
Right. So thank you. A lot of times, like you said, the clinical picture would give it away. And in any case, though we have not discussed the last case, which was a mixed AIHA, the treatment for both the warm AIHA and the mixed AIHA are essentially the first line treatment is the steroid. So it's safe to start steroids if one is getting an IgG positive DAD plus or minus the C3 positive.
Yeah.
So
I think the really challenging ones are the ones where DAD is negative. And I think everybody's probably dealt with those cases.
Right. So they're definitely, like, we are looking at hemolytic anemias, and often what happens is that we do a bone marrow and an NGS also and do not get anything positive. And then you start thinking whether it might be a DAD negative hemolytic anemia, and a trial of steroids might actually give you the answer in that kind of a situation. So fortunately, like you said, such cases are very rare and we don't often come across them. So I think there are no more questions in the chat box. So I will stop here, and Dr. Sunil, over to you. If there is, I'll stop here, I guess. So, Dr. Sunil, you are muted. We cannot hear you. Hello, Sunil, you are muted.
While he comes back, I had a little doubt in Ashish's first case where, that's really intriguing that the blood group would get typed as AB. When it comes to the RH, they would not be preformed antibodies, right? But with the anti-D, they would agglutinate because it's a pan-agglutinin. So so is that also a clue that something's going on? Why would a child, I don't know.
Oh, yeah, see. It won't be an RH, won't be a problem. Usually it's ABO which creates problem. Because what happens is, like, these antisera, they are monoclonal high titer antisera. So if you, like, if they are cold agglutinins, you're already, your sample is having those agglutinins. So even if you don't add them with antisera, they will give rise to a visible agglutination. So if you just put a drop of such sample in a test tube and centrifuge it, it will just give an appearance of agglutination even without adding any reagent. So very simple and important method is to do a warm saline washes of the sample. So what it will do is it will just remove all unbound agglutinins from the remaining plasma of the red cells. So these washed, warm saline washes will ensure that red cells are there with either bound or unbound agglutinins. Bound agglutinins won't affect much because these antisera are very specific to A and B and D antigen. They won't bind to any other antigen. They are high titer monoclonal commercial antisera. But if you have some unbound agglutinins, so what will happen is in the picture of this antisera, they will partly bind to these antisera and give rise to a false agglutination picture. So warm saline washes will lead to a clarity of picture to some extent. It may not be helpful in warm AIHA, but in cold cases, it is definitely helpful. And that's why you have a second evidence, corroborative evidence from the reverse grouping. Because in reverse grouping, patient will have either anti-A, anti-B or both or none, along with an autoantibody, which will be manifested in auto-control or autologous control, where you just react red cell with the patient's own serum or plasma. So you have to take a comprehensive view of the findings with the forward, reverse and autologous, and then just like corroborate them and reach a conclusion regarding the blood. So if you don't do the reverse grouping, like we faced one case where a patient came with an HTR and he was transfused AB positive red cells. After a week's time, his all these red cells, because he must have encountered a very severe hemolytic episode. And there was a history of hemoglobinuria, cola colored urine, everything, dark color, high colored urine history was there. And when we just grouped it, the simple reverse grouping resolved the picture. There was no problem with the reverse grouping. The reverse grouping was suggestive of just group B while he was transfused with AB. So this will give rise to an immediate HTR. So this is the very basic thing which can be dealt with at any level of care, I think. But people are not aware of this thing. It's like even in transfusion services, they are not so much familiar with this phenomenon.
So thank you very much, Ashish. I'm sorry, I think I couldn't unmute myself. I had logged off and then I couldn't be made host probably. So Richa, a couple of questions, which have also come up is, one is, how long you're going to be waiting for rituximab to show response? I think your case you showed was, I think after four or fifth dose, there was some response. Okay. So one question is that. And the second question is, Prashant showed that in one of the slides on bortezomib in the cold antibody type. So what is, bortezomib role in refractory warm antibody as well? If you could just take these two questions.
Can you repeat the last question?
So second was on bortezomib as a, treatment modality for the refractory warm antibody type.
Okay. So I would say that bortezomib is not that frequently used in the pediatric age group. Like I said, the secondary AIHA is azathioprine, the mycophenolate mofetil, and tacrolimus actually are the drugs which are most commonly used. And lately, for the last few years, tacrolimus is fast becoming the preferred third line agent, specifically because a lot of warm AIHA, secondary warm AIHA is associated with ALPS and ALPS-like syndrome, which show a beautiful response to tacrolimus, also to MMF, but tacrolimus also helps in decreasing the splenomegaly and controlling the other symptoms of ALPS. So I am really not sure if there is, at least we have never discussed bortezomib in any patient. And whatever literature I had looked up also does not mention bortezomib as a very commonly used therapy in the pediatric age group. Maybe Prashant, if he is, like he mentioned it, so maybe he would like to comment further. Prashant, would you like to say something on this?
Like it's a proteasome inhibitor, ma'am. Recently tried like CTLA-4 inhibitors, PD-1 inhibitors, and this bortezomib.
Yes. CTLA-4 inhibitors are tried with specific PIDs like CTLA-4 mutations. And in some certain case reports, it's been seen case series that they are even useful in very refractory AIHAs. You are right about that.
Yeah, and rituximab. So thank you for that, Richa. I think, yes, there are some case reports on bortezomib in refractory AIHAs, especially those ones who have responded to rituximab initially and have responded to rituximab, but have relapsing. So in relapsing, the refractory AIHA who has responded to rituximab before, some case reports on that. And I think someone has put the chat box post-transplant as well in some case patients.
Yes,
now rituximab, yes. How long will you wait? I mean, I think you waited for a few weeks.
Yes, 6 weeks at least. 6 weeks at least we would wait. So till 6 weeks to maybe slightly longer, depending on the clinical situation, because it does take that kind of time to kick in. If we look at the box I had shown for rituximab, that's what it mentions. Yes.
So typically the response starts occurring in 2 to 3 weeks period.
Yes, but we would wait a bit longer because the third line therapies are way more kind of toxic to start. So in this child, we were rewarded in the sense that after a couple of weeks of the sixth dose, he did show some response and actually a good response. And now she's actually 4 years off all steroids, all immunosuppression, a well-thriving child, totally healthy.
All right. So I don't know if this question was taken, but there was one more question that is natural history of DAT negative AIHA. I think Anand had asked that question. I'm not sure whether it was taken already.
No, it was not taken. Okay. Yes, I'm looking at it now. And
Anand is used to asking difficult questions, so it's okay. I mean, you can deal with it.
Then again.
No, I said Anand is used to asking difficult questions, so you can take that.
I'll say I do not know the answer to that.
Yeah.
Generally, ma'am, they have a milder course and they're steroid responsive. That is the
good. Thank you, Prashant. So here's the answer.
All right. So I think that's it. I think we had a very fantastic session, and especially from the lab point of view, you know, great practical tips. And this is something which we kind of, do not put too much of stress on. I think it's very useful for our residents, especially for training to have a different perspective from the lab point of view. These are some of these kind of difficult scenarios, and lots of permutations, combinations, take into consideration. Thank you very much, Richa, Dr. Prashant Sharma, Dr. Ashish, as well as Prashant. Prashant, you did a fantastic job, great cases, and nice discussion interspersed between the cases. And thank you very much for your time. And thank you, Anand and Neeta, for the coordinating these sessions. And thank you, Ria and Echo, for the technical platform which I've been providing. So have a good evening, friends, and we'll see you again in 2 weeks' time. Good night.
Good night. Good night, everyone.
Thank you.